Okay, good morning, everybody. Are you ready for today? Today we have another interesting topic about reducing greenhouse gas emission relating to climate change. And before we start the lecture, I will take our photo and please turn on your camera. Okay. One, two, three, capture. Okay, thank you. Oh, we have more participants. Okay. And if you have any question, you can send to the chat box. And the speaker will answer you in our website later. The speaker today is Associate Professor Dr. Tanwadi Suksaro. Currently, she is the lecturer at Asian Institute for Health Development, Thailand. She graduates Doctor of Science in Food Sciences from University of Montpellier, France. Master and bachelor degree in environmental technology and environmental health sciences from Mahidol University. She has over 20 years of teaching, research experience, and many publications in environmental technology. She is also Carbon Footprint Assessor Thailand and consultant for environmental management in many agro industries. So our topic today is reducing greenhouse gases emission from agricultural sector in order to improving and maintaining the resilience to climate change. So now is the time to listen the lecture from Associate Professor Dr. Tanwadi Suksaro. Please give us some lecture.
So thank you very much for the moderator. Good morning, everyone. So very pleasure to be here as your speaker in today's sessions, and also we will meet again in tomorrow's sessions. So first of all, there's congratulations that you have been selected from TAIGA to participate in this training course. I come from Mahidol University, so and actually in Mahidol Universities also we have the annual inter training course for many participants around the world. And for TAIGA, I can inform you that after you completed any training program from TAIGA, so in Thailand, the Thailand International Cooperation Agencies, and also the partners like Kasisat Universities or many universities in Thailand, we will call you as TAIGA alumni. So I suggest you that also please visit the TAIGA website, because every year the TAIGA have offer many opportunity, including training course, of course, and also the scholarship for master degree, for graduate degree, and also other chance in terms of research and everything. And so then the TAIGA alumni will be the prioritized on that. So anyway, it means after this, so we are become as a network, and also you are our alumni. So then just keep in contact. So today's session, I think I was invited by Department of Irrigation Engineering to share with you with my experience about the greenhouse gases emissions and also some kind of concept that I think maybe, okay, some of you maybe have been heard about that, or some of you maybe partially work on that, but hopefully that is the thing that we have been sharing and learned together today. So we'll be like make you in term to touch upon in the some kind of frame that we would like to attempt in the part in encompassing with the agricultural sector. I think former sessions, Dr. Gevela Dr. Warawut already introduces you about the importance of climate change, especially the impact of climate change on water, and also, of course, the consequence impact on in terms of the water supplying to the agricultural sectors. So today, maybe I just talking the same issue, but in the reverse way. So in terms that, okay, agriculture sectors or water supply sectors is considering as the climate change victim. But at the same time, also agricultural sectors and include all sector also is a significant contributor to climate change. So it means at the same time that we try to find out the way that we can coping ourselves to be existing in the climate change era. At the same time, we have to promising ourselves in terms how we can do something to in terms to supporting the climate change response and coping in terms that actually we would like to prevent ourselves to be more safe from climate change impact in coming or in the long futures or maybe many years from now. So the mapping of my lecture, I will start it again, attempt to use a little bit again, but maybe leave us with the former session, because I would like to attempt you what kind of significance of agricultural sector contributing to the climate change. And also in terms to responding to climate change, we have to do something in terms to increase the resiliency of this sector, but we have to do by ourselves to increase ourselves and to be more resilient, because we already are being in the climate change era. And also the concept and the measure that is a global or international concept and measure agree with our nation in the world that talking about that, it's about adaptations and mitigation. And I would like to introduce you based on that my experience, my expert, as Dr. Tsubishia introduced me, I am the carbon footprint assessor for Thailand. So it is one tool that can help all sector, including agricultural sector, to design the appropriate measures to increasing their capacity to respond to climate change. Maybe, okay, the results maybe come in terms of some kind of dimension, but finally, the final target is everyone try to do everything to coping or to save our world for the more severe or more longer impact from climate change. And I would like to share some case study and my research experience on that, okay? So I think based on the available information now, so everyone no doubt that climate is changing. And just one important point that when we are talking about climate, it is different from, a little bit different from weather. When we are talking about weather change, weather is mean we are focusing on the short period or cross-sectional condition of something. For example, weather today at my hometown now is rainy, cloudy sky, so it is the weather. But when we are talking about climate change, we are referred to the changing over long period. Over long period. For example, maybe you are already heard that in over 100 period passes, so the average of global temperature is increasing at some at such level. And the latest IPCC reported quite to be sure that just in the next 2 decades, our average global temperature will be reached to changing almost 2 degrees Celsius. Just okay, what kind of the matter of temperature that okay, Dr. Kevila also introduces. Just thinking comparing to ourselves. Actually, I'm just recovered from COVID-19 infections. This is just the first day that I come out from the home isolation. When the body temperature is just increasing 1 or 2 degrees Celsius, is it mean can change you, turn you down from the normal condition to be very crisis conditions in terms of body function. So the world or our earth did the same. Did the same. Is it mean just only 0.2, 0.3 degrees Celsius occurring in the very big mass of the world? So it's changing a lot in terms of their own system, especially the ecosystem and the thing. Anything. So every organization, every organic, every scientific report confirm at the same time without doubting about that. Our global average temperature is increasing continuously. And from your in your right hand side, you can see some small graph. So we're quite sure that after the era of European industrialization, global revolutions that we come up to be as an industrialized era. So this is a starting point that the our temperatures, our global temperature is increasing continually from that. So this come from that maybe you already know, because now we have exist of some kind of level of some gases in our ambience. The main actor is carbon dioxide. Back to industrialize, of course, this is the time that we know that. We know the way that to changing from traditional productions to be the modernized productions, we can produce the mass of products we can secure in terms of the global need, but it is come up with the overconsumption of energies. And when you combust any fuel, of course it's released carbon dioxide. So now carbon dioxide is the main contributor to the changing of quantity of ambient gases. And of course, if these gases can absorb the heat radiations that come from the sun and reflect from the some kinds of the reflection mechanisms from our Earth surface, so then any kind of gases that can absorb the heat radiation, including a long wave that reflected from the Earth surface after they absorb the sun radiation and then reflect. Any gas that have the capable to be that to do that we call greenhouse gases. And even though the water vapors in the ambience also this is the greenhouse gases, but now we quite seem obviously that, okay, the quantity of greenhouse gases, the type of greenhouse gases that increasing sharply and obviously has become as the heating gas for our world now in this era is carbon dioxide. Actually, based on the scientific research and data synthesis or something, this is not the first time of global warming that come up with the climate change. We already passed a phenomenon like this many times since the world is come up in the universe, but the main actor of greenhouse gases is different. For our world now, current now, is this effect from level of carbon dioxide. The scientific scientists estimated that the appropriate concentrations of carbon dioxide in the world to maintain the balance, greenhouse effects, carbon cycles, and everything, it just allowed 315 ppm in the ambient. But we passed that point for many years already. So now we quite to be reached to 350 ppm, something like that. So does it mean now we have the exceed of greenhouse gases quantity in the ambience, and of course it's the make up more the heat radiation absorbed in the air, in the gas around us. So of course it then consequences the surface temperatures of our world increases and affect to our system in the world. But the next gases is become as the main actor too, based on the latest scientific report, is methane. And what is the impact from climate change? So maybe I can skip on that. You already learned. This is a report that I mentioned to you. IPCC is acting as the scientific institute that, okay, capture and do everything, analyze data for us to inform the world, all nations, all country, to know about the situations of greenhouse gases emission and climate change in our world. The latest report in this year warned that now the world is already set to reach the increasing of 1.5 degrees Celsius level within next two decades that I already said. And from now, only the immediately cut in carbon emission that can help to prevent an environmental disaster that become more severe in the time coming soon. So IPCC is only one organization that received the Nobel Prize in terms that, okay, that they do everything to try to come up the world to know the our situations and try to come up with the together with cooperation, coordination between all country in terms to that we keep on hand together and part this problem together. So UNFCC, this is the international parties for all country, and IPCC to acting as like a academic information provider to UNFCC in terms to introduce the guideline or some common policy for all countries to do that. Like every country, including Thailand, I think your country also, every year we have to submit the report about the greenhouse gases emission in each country to IPCC. So then IPCC can know about the, okay, strength, weakness, what is the kind of threat that some countries, some region still facing in terms of trying to coping the climate change, and so then they analyze and then presenting all information to back to the international parties and international parties to agree with some kind of to develop some common policy to working together. So this is important of greenhouse gas. The key points of climate change is now human are the main driver of climate change for our era, for our era. 90% of exceeded greenhouse gases in our ambient now, this is artificial greenhouse gases. Is it mean originate from human activity, not come from the natural, not come from the volcano eruptions, not come from the like the fermentations in the some wetland or something like that, but come from us. Is it confirmed? And now, move from carbon dioxide, we also have to willing to take notice of methane level. So they become as the next actor that also contributing to the climate change, maybe significantly as carbon dioxide, even though around the world emit the methane in the lower level much than carbon dioxide. And we are close to reaching a reversible tipping point. Is it mean like when you learned about we call elasticity, like when you have the masses, you have the ear loop, like the ear loop have elasticity. You are, when you stretch it, them so okay, they can like stretch back, okay. But if you input more strain, on this loop again and again until they part tipping point, so they cannot irreversible. So you lose that mass. This is one. So this is the same thing. Also have the overall have the limitation that can absorb or adapt themselves to coping everything that we have been done with them. But if we pass at that point, is it mean maybe no reversible? The everything in our ecosystem maybe cannot come back. So what is the signals when we already pass that point? Forest could start to die, and sea level will continue to rise. Just only last night that I watched the television news that there are the glacier, the ice, some iceberg in the some country that they found some leakage on that. So is it mean the signal of melting again? So it mean very, 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 very concerned because actually if we learn about the water stock of our world, actually the fresh water stock around the world is come from that iceberg or glacier in the very high mountain. This is a stock of fresh water for all river or canal in the world. And so now it's melt. And without enough additional stock, because now the climate also is very, very, very like a mad, like someone is still sick. When the winter come, but snow not come. When the rainy is alive, but just a few rain come. But during in the summers, we don't need much something, but the rainy is come every day. Something like this, the pattern of weather is changing. So then it also affect the stock of fresh water. The fresh water is melt every day, where melt. But in the winter, some year no snow to increase, to like fill up the stock that already releasing during the summer. So then all stock is flow into the downland and go to the sea. But this year, sorry that the world not provide the filling up of fresh water in kind of snow or rain. Is this a dry year, sorry? So then, does it mean the stock of water is decreasing year by year, day by day? And of course, finally, in some year, maybe we have to, be facing with some kind of water shortage. And also like now in Thailand that we are in the Mekong region, we call Mekong region, we connected with the other country with the one main river we call Mekong. But the original of Mekong River is come from China and past Myanmar, past Thailand, and also some part of Laos and continue until into the sea something. So but because of the climate change, we have the climate change. As I told you that when the filling up of the water stock is decreasing year by year, year by year. So then does it mean make the some year the Mekong River is dry and affect a lot of many people who living beside this river in China until Laos. So this is will be come up with more seriously. And okay. More seriously. This is that I would like to show you that it is okay. This graph show continuous about some key greenhouse gases. Okay, carbon dioxide, methane, nitrate oxide, and you can see that the CFC chlorofluorocarbons, hydrochlorofluorocarbons, the thing. Oh, this curve is just seem to be okay. It's like it seem to be decreasing or not increasing much. Why? These gases are banned from our world for many years. That we know that these kind of chemicals we use in the frozen industry. And after we found from 20 years ago, almost 30 years ago, we found that these gases can cause of the ozone depletion in the upper atmosphere. And so then after we know that they okay destroy in terms of the ozone layers, so we banned it. It means don't use anymore, and we remove from the from the market, and okay we produce other chemical instead. So the level of this kind of gas is decreasing, and the ozone depletion is better. And what happened? This curve to show that. Since the very long time, okay, carbon dioxide, methane, nitrate oxide maybe contribute, of course, okay, from us too, but this is based on the natural mechanism somewhere also. But CFC, for example, chlorofluorocarbon 11, we just found these molecules of gases in our ambient just after the Industrial Revolution. So is it mean? This is a 100 man-made greenhouse gases. This is come from us 100%. And of course, fortunately that we ban it now. And so then it's made now the level of this is decreasing. But other gases, carbon dioxide, nitrate oxide, and methane, the main three greenhouse gases actor, contributor, is still increasing. And what is the importance of methane and nitrate oxide? What is the important one? Carbon dioxide used as the reference gas for this current climate change era, because this is the main actor, main contributor in terms of global warming and climate change. So other gas, we will comparing everything with carbon dioxide. You can see that on the one column that we call global warming potential. And this table present 20 years global warming potential GWP and 100 years. Normally the reference that we use is 100 years. What does it mean? For example, nitrous oxide, that the main contributor is from fertilizers or from agricultural sector, or methane also. 310 of GWP. Does it mean it can absorb? Does it mean global warming potential means how much of the 1 ton of these gases can absorb the heat radiation comparing to carbon dioxide. So even though now methane or nitrogen oxide and other greenhouse gases may be emitted much lower than carbon dioxide, but if we comparing with the global warming potentials, they have very high, much higher than carbon dioxide. So does it mean the significant factors when we focus on the global warming and climate change impacts from any gas, not only the quantity, the global warming potential is also important because the methane can absorb around 21 times more than carbon dioxide in terms of absorb the heat radiation over 100 period, over 100 year period. Nitrogen oxide is more than methane. And for the gases like that we already banned, like hydrofluorocarbon, is more than 1,000 times of the carbon dioxide. But okay, we remove them all. But methane and nitrogen oxide, how we can do? Carbon dioxide, okay, mean is maybe come from the combustions for the energy productions. Maybe, okay, the industrialized community takes a responsibility also, but methane and nitrate oxide. What is the facts about this gas? 24% of our greenhouse gas emission contribute by agriculture and forestry sector. And of course, if we go to in terms of the type of gases, agriculture produce much in terms of methane. So then the 40% of global carbon and anthropogenic methane emission approximately contributed by agricultural factor. And also 52 million ton of crop loss or agricultural product losses can be prevented if we can reduce short-lived climate pollutant emission. So now, actually, we are starting come to talking about food security because now before in many years after the Second World War, that we quite sure that after we have the very known technologies to prevent the losses of product from agricultural sector. We learn to use the chemicals, we learn to use the herbicide, everything to protect our food, But now we come up to have another challenge for that. Okay, not only the technology can save the our food, but how about the rain, how about the temperatures, how about what the kind of ambient physical factors that now we cannot predict it. And sometimes can make our food to be insecure again. And this is to show about the significance of agricultural sectors contribute to climate change. In totally, the greenhouse gases emissions compute for all 6 key greenhouse gases. So now agricultural contribute around 28% of total greenhouse gases emission. That you can see that if we divide in detail, residential, commercial, quite 20%, agriculture and industrial is the same. Not come that like, okay, we think that, okay, climate change is come from industry, not like that. And also based on if we focus on agricultural in the last 10 years, emission is increased annually by 8%. We also, why we have to adapt to everything. Farmers have to adapt themselves for the unpredictable weather each year, changing each year, but also at the same time, they also everything that they do as daily also contribute to emit the greenhouse gases. For agricultural sector, 8% annually. And of course, if we diverse the contribution in each region in the world, Asia contributing at the most, because most of the country in Asia continent is agricultural based countries. And the second is Latin America and Africa, of course, all of us is this agricultural based country. So we can contributing to the climate change also. And if we go deeper in agricultural sector, greenhouse gases come from which part? First, the first rank is enteric fermentation. So it is a part of livestock. It's a part of livestock. And after that, it is a livestock menu that cannot well manage from synthesis fertilizer using, from rice cultivation. And after that, about the burning or some crop residue management and sometimes of the drainage, organic soil and wastewater. So because in all international policy call for the commitment of our country to do something in response to climate change. So then now we have to approach that in deploy or intervene in all sector, of course, including agricultural sector in all country, should thinking and have to adopt this approach also. First, we call the many activity in agricultural sector is being asked to reduce the emission of and stabilizing the level of heat trapping greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. We call mitigation. And at the same time, because we are facing with the impact of the climate change, so during that we try to do everything to reduce the emission from our farm, also the farmer was asked to adapt themselves in some way that can be being with the climate variations and that protect them from the loss of the product or anything. There are two high approach we call mitigation and adaptation. Adapted. You change some behavior, you change some practice in the farm, so the farmer is adapting. Mitigation is, or maybe some kind of practice may be related with the adaptations also. But if they can claim that to be that can reduce the greenhouse gases emission from the farm or from the agricultural something also, so we call mitigation. So this is kind of two measures have to be implemented together as parallel to be adapt, is it to save the farmer to be can be being and facing and can be absorb the any kind of impact that occurring now, and also mitigation to prevent the more severity in terms that can be caused by the continuously greenhouse gases emission. So everyone have to take responsibility, try to reduce the greenhouse gases emission from their activity also. So this is mitigation. So this is example for examples. For example, adaptation like for examples, maybe they are changing some infrastructure. If you are being in the, you're staying in the flood prone area, so then in every year, so you try to changing some infrastructure in your area to prevent the flooding. This is adaptation. It's just adaptation. But mitigation Is it mean you do something, try to reduce in terms of the reduce the greenhouse gases emission, like we change to use like fuel combustion energies to be alternative energies or renewable energy. So it means you reduce the consumption of some kind of resources. And of course, comparing with the greenhouse gases emission between fossil fuel and renewable fuel or alternative fuel. So alternative fuel like a solar cells or water, some hydro powers, it is a more in term like more environmental friendly. They reduce in term of unit less than the fossil fuels, some kind like that. I will give you the okay in detail and some examples later about that. So is it mean adaptation and mitigation? When we are implementing this kind of two approach together, you change something, change practice in the farm, because is it mean, for example, in some country, in agricultural sector, they try to develop some we call modified genetic plant. For example, we know that the temperature is higher. So some kind of plant like a rice or some crop is very sensitive to the temperature variation. So the scientists try to modify the genetic to be more heat resistant for rice or some economic crop, for examples. So these, when they produce in the laboratories, and so then they distribute to the farmers, is that mean the farmer changing the plant type to use the heat resistant serotypes of their plants in their farm. So is this adaptation? Because it means their production will be more resilient to the temperature. They can resist for a while in terms of heat radiation more than some traditional plants or serotypes, for example. And so then the mitigations, for example, the farmers try to do something, for example, they recycle the waste, some wastewater or some waste from the farm to be used as the materials, raw material in the farm operations. For example, in Thailand, the pig farm or in the smoke rubber sheet that I will show you my research later. So they know that the wastewater from some farming can be used as the biogas fermentation substance. So then the wastewater not necessarily to discharge into the environment, they can capture. And they can use this wastewater to produce the biogas. And what is the biogas can do? Biogas contain much, the gas contain inside of biogas is methane. So then they can use this biogas to produce the energy, or even though to produce some electricity based on some kind of instrument or engine. So they can produce the energy to produce electricity or to use in their own farm. So for like this, we call mitigation. And what if they will impact to their farm resilience? Of course, even though now the cost of energy is increasing, the cost of fuels that use the farm is increasing, but if the farmer, they can produce their own energy, so of course they have more resilience. They can resist and absorb the some kind of the impact shock or impact strain from the anything that are really fluctuate now. So then this is the kind of mitigation and adaptation measures in our sector. Actually, it is the design and convinced to implement it to increasing their own resilience, of course, including the farmers. or agricultural sector also. Normally, or maybe I just expand a little bit. So adaptability is it mean the system is have a capacity to adjust, reorganize, and modify in terms of response to shock and stress. Maybe I just thinking that the in kind of adaptability. Actually, if we go through deeper of adaptability, there are three levels. Sometimes resilience and adaptability are defined as the same thing. First, we call absorption. Second, we call adaptation. The third is transformation. It is we call resilient because there are many kind of researchers and organizations defined for that. Sometimes resilient is the same definition with adapt, but adapt defined to be different level, or sometimes adapt is one kind of level in resilient. What is the action that every sector can deploy in terms to increase resilience? Absorption, they can absorb. For example, if you go to buy some food to stock in your house, because you know that next month, maybe is it possible that the flooding come and you cannot go out to buy the food for a few days, or even though now it's a COVID-19 and we don't sure that, or maybe in the first or second wave that we found it in some country, there are the shortage of food stock or something because the transportation and everything in the world is like interrupted from the COVID-19. So then we go to buy the food to stock in our house because to be like a preparedness all the time. If something happens, anyway, we can stay more 1 week without need for help. This is the absorption. So in terms of farming, what is the kind that the farmer can do? Adaptation is it mean you start to changing something. You changing yourself. For example, okay. I give example is adaptation. You go to buy the food. But absorption is it mean, okay, you did not anything, but you can resist with the problem for a such period. It is absorption. If in Thailand, in the central of Thailand, some area have a flooding annually. So the people didn't do anything, but they know that, okay, next month it is a flooding season. So they just, okay, stay with that, don't do anything, and just, okay, prepare everything as usual. So they think that, okay, normally just a week and then the water will be gone so they can stay. It is absorb. But this is to be at adaptation. Okay, they start to build up some wall or something to prevent the water coming into their house because they would like to protect some kitchen garden. They would like to protect some of their assets. So they change something, they increase some infrastructure to prevent the flooding. This is adaptation. And transformation, for example, if, okay, flooding come annually, I could not stay anymore with the water every year. And maybe it is come more frequency because it is a climate change. So I move my house to other village or to the higher area. It's transformation. And this definition used as the same definition in all discipline. If you talking in the health system, also we call health resilience. We call health resilience. Absorption is that mean, okay, normal health system are being like this, but if emerging disease come, pandemic come, and that country can absorb, okay, can still be on function, even though the infectious rate is increasing sharply within 1 week, but they can still okay coping their people, save their people, have enough bed, have enough everything. It is absorbed. But this is adaptation. Is that mean okay? Maybe if the emerging disease or pandemic come, so our health system cannot absorb. We have to thinking something. So maybe the government maybe relocated the budget from other sectors to pull up, to filling up in the health system, relocate the budget or do something to be respond to the pandemic. So it is adaptation. And transformation, for example, maybe from my country. Also now, the partner in terms to respond to the COVID-19, not only the Ministry of Public Health, but also we are the cooperation of Ministry of Interior, because the village health volunteer and everything from that partner can cooperate with Ministry of Public Health in terms to cooperate everything to respond to protect the people from infections. So this is a changing the infrastructure, is transformation. So this is the same definition for our discipline in terms of resilience. So the agricultural sector, it is also the same. Oh, sorry. Okay. So then, to avoid the serious impact of the all climate change, the main reduction in greenhouse gases is required for especially for the agricultural sector. If we are talking about greenhouse gases emission, so how can the farmer practice can cut emission? It has to be started from the point that they have can be explained their own carbon footprint. You would like to cut something, like you would like to save a budget. You have to know first what is the budget is expend for. And you just cut off some point that make your budget is to be minus or to be negative. So this is the same. If the concept of carbon footprint not clarified clearly, so then in terms to design some practice to cut the emission is impossible. So this is the point that I come be here, what invited today. Actually, in the concept of ecosystem approach, this is not only the carbon. Maybe I can start it in terms of this. The concept of ecosystem approach. We are the level, or not level, the step. Since the generation source until create the impact to the human or any part of ecosystem. For example, you're just considering this part. They are the way that we can respond to the any kind of environmental issues by use this approach. First, for example, if we considering about this process, you started from the okay, we combat the fuel to produce the energy for any activities. From fuel combustion, you release the carbon dioxide gases into the environment. So if you measure the carbon dioxide here, we call you measuring environmental loading. You measure the environmental load into the environment. After that, the environmental load maybe can create the another kind of impact at the consequential. For example, fuel combustion release carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is the first point of environmental load. And carbon dioxide, of course, it is greenhouse gases. Greenhouse gases can do what? Can absorb the heat radiation. So then, can be heat radiation absorb more, can impact to the climate change. So the climate change is consequence impact from environmental load that we call midpoint. And if the climate change, of course, that we know can also contribute to another impact. For example, they change the precipitation intensity. This is another point. Also, even though now, like a COVID-19 that we are being with, some of part of the cause of re-emerging disease or emerging disease in our world now also contributes in some kind of climate change condition. And of course, when this impact occur, or even though like, the rainfall or precipitation intensity change, that impact to the human, reach to the human already, we call endpoint. So we just thinking that to manage the impact from environment, we have the option. For example, we option to manage endpoint. Okay, COVID come, monkeypox come, maybe in the next few years something come. So we will manage that point, or we back to manage midpoint. That quite very hard to manage the climate system in the world. Actually, when you read would like to manage midpoint, is it mean you have to manage environmental loss? So then you can see that in every country, I sure that every country, we have the regulation or the law to control the pollution. For example, the industry should not discharge the wastewater that contaminated more than 20 milligram per liter of BOD, cannot discharge the wastewater contaminated more than 120 of COD. So actually, we decide to control environmental load. We decide control environmental load. So then we did the same. That's why the mitigation measure, what is to be the approach that all country was is recommended and is convinced by all international policy to do. Is it mean if we would like to prevent the impact from climate change, we have to go back to control environmental loaded since the original source. We cannot climate change come, so no more water for the paddy rice, for the rice farming this year. So then irrigation department, find out more water for them. If you do like this, you are located on this point. Okay, if you don't have this water, so I will relocate the water from another district, another province for you, because you need for the farm. And how about that area? That area have to facing another problem with the water shortage, but can fulfill the need for this one. So the manage on endpoint is quite, it's good, but not to fit much in terms to produce the sustainable in terms of the society. So then normally we have to go back always. Try to manage in the first. So this is the concept of mitigation and adaptation. And also, when you know that climate change can create many kind of impact. If you concern the impact in terms of the climate change, it is changing to be climate change. So is it mean you try to manage CO2? If you are concerning about the endpoint impact about the water scarcity or water shortage, so you have to try to control water consumption that we call water footprint. If we concern many kind of impact together, we concern that we try to control everything to try to minimize the impact to water, minimize the impact to climate change, minimize the impact of the human toxicity in terms like when you use the pesticide, for example, in the agricultural sector. If you come up together to compute all impact together and try to control the environmental load in many variables of environmental load, we call product footprint. So now the main function or the main tools that do to design the technologies or design the measure will be implemented in all sector, industrial, agriculture, or industrial and agriculture now, or even though in the residential sector, the commercial sector, or like a residential sector, there are two main tools that are identified and talking much in our country. This is a carbon footprint and water footprint. Actually, what is it? Carbon footprint and water footprint is it mean you try to measure how much that you release environmental loaded into the environment. And when we know that, so is it mean we try to reduce the load. We really try to reduce the load by finding the where is the hotspot in our system, release much the load, and we hit to that point. So finally, we can reduce the environmental load, of course, consequent impact to reduce the midpoint impact. And finally, is it mean we are serving the world by reduce the impact of endpoint. So this is the basic concept of mitigation and adaptation and come up to connectivity to the carbon footprint and water footprint. So now, also I just found this work from some report. Of course, in terms to reduce a farm or estate carbon footprint, someone said that it's a very long-term process. And also, even though the farmer adjusts their activity now, but how they reduce the climate change is so far from them to show them that, okay, you are the hero, you are saving the world. But actually, we didn't put all government, all country don't show that you reduce this gas, and so then is it mean you don't emit that gas, and so then the temperature is decreasing immediately. Not like that, but actually we can show them in the kind of something that can convince them to reduce the carbon footprint. So even though it is a long-term period in terms of impact, but actually if we understanding about this kind of tool, it can be convince the farmer to do that and the benefit in the short term that they can get immediately. This is about the climate change long-term impact, but it's about their own benefit to the farm. Why to be like that? For examples, because of the when you measure the carbon footprint, you measure the environmental load to the that the farm emitted to the ambient. But actually, you can get the value of carbon footprint or greenhouse gases emission. Why you have to computing up from the all inventory or all of the resources and the thing that you're spending in your crop cycle. You have to know that. And I will show you the way to compute that, okay? And when you know that, if you get the final carbon footprint, but actually behind the scene, the farmer or the owner of some industry, they know that, oh, actually, what is the point that I can save, that I can reduce the resource or inventory use? Okay, in the presentation, it's like you would like to reduce the carbon emissions, but actually, it is come from that the farmer can touch on the point that, oh, this point that I could change. And then they can change, they can, is it mean they can save some costs. And when they save the cost, they save also, they reduce the carbon footprint. This is the interlinkage, something like this. Based on my experience, when I working with the manufacturer, in the when I working with company, or I working with a farmer also, but it very big farmer, when they ask me to compute the carbon footprint for them, the first day that's always I have to explain them why we have to do carbon footprint, because if we cannot measure, so we cannot know what the thing that we can do to save your cost. Okay, if I convince you have to do like this, because you are saving the world, they did not interested on that. But if I convince them that you have to measure carbon footprints, because finally I can help you to find a way can save the processing cost, you will get more profit, they're interested. But the point will come together when the manufacturer or the big farm can save the cost. Is that mean they save to the use of excess resources or raw materials? They save the cost, they get more profit, but actually we also reduce the carbon emission. So environment and economy have to come together. In Thailand, we set up the government set up one organization we call Thailand Greenhouse Gases Organization, or TGO. And also in some year, not some year, in the last few years ago, also the government subsidized to the many factories or the farm who would like to volunteer to compute the carbon footprint. And okay, they will like give some support to them, give a budget to the farm. Because after they know the carbon footprint, so they will know, realize themselves, okay, what part of farm, what part of factory that have to lose something without necessarily. So after that, they try to decide something to save the loss in their processing. So then finally, is it mean they can help the government in terms to reduce the carbon footprint. And so then when the government counted for the greenhouse gases emission for the overall country, so they can claim that they contributing in terms of the reducing the country greenhouse gases emission profile. So this is the way that the Thailand government doing. So now there are more than 1,000, I think, more than 1,000 agricultural products in Thailand that certified by carbon footprint. And one of my customers, this is not agricultural exactly, but that factory produced the crab meat, canned crab meat. Is that mean, okay, when the fisherman kept the crab, the bull crab from the sea, so that processing just extracts only the crab meat, and then they put in the can, the metal can. And most of the product is sent to Europe. It's sent to Europe to sell in Europe, in European countries. And they asked me to compute the carbon footprint for them because at that year, five years ago, France, asked all products sent to sale on shelf in France have to declare carbon footprints. So that is quite to be trade barrier, right? But okay, when we are talking that, because we would like to declare to the society that this product is how much friendly to the environment, especially about the climate change. So then that factory asked me to compute carbon footprint for them. that they can declare on their product and can send to selling in Europe. And in that case, also the factory ask some support from the government, from the government through the some kind of the project, and the government pay for them in terms of the all of the cost that have to do in terms of carbon footprint computation, something like that. So this is also like a quite okay complicated, but just would like to show you that to see. And another case that I did it because it also sometimes tend to be like the trade barrier about the rubber smoke cheese from Thailand, even though okay, it is not a food product, but Thailand also is the main exporter of rubber in the world. And in comparing with another country, we have to declare also what is the kind of rubber product from our country. How is this friendly to the greenhouse gases environment in terms of greenhouse gases emission? So this is the thing that international platform are talking. So this is the one project that you can introduce into your country or your area. If it's still not starting, does it mean try to help the farming system in your area started to determine themselves in terms of the greenhouse gases emission? But actually, they will show them that what is the point that there are overuse of resources in their farm. And after that, they can say, they can everything. Another customer is the banana farming. It's a banana farming. But because in the some of supermarket ask all the product that's selling in the supermarket have to declare carbon footprint. So then I compute that I will show you that the some kind of value and the way that I have been working. And finally, what is the banana farm owner get from my carbon footprint assessment? And they have to pay me because I am their consultant, because I can, in addition from that, I can make the value of carbon footprint on their own fresh banana. And they can send to the big supermarket based on their requirement. But I can show them also, what is the point that you are overpaying in your farm? You are overpaying, not necessarily. You can save more something. This is the way that actually behind the scene of carbon footprint can do. Also water footprint in the tomorrow, okay? Carbon emission always show by carbon footprint. This is the way that I show by country, for example. They divide per capita. Thailand is around 3.6, comparing to China, 7.1. Quite sure that your country also, you have your own carbon emission profile. But normally, the country that have the carbon emission per capita very high, normally most of them located in the developed country, in Europe, United States, or America. Normally, the developing country is quite not we call that okay. We emit, but not significant level in comparing with the developed country. But anyway, when the climate change impact come, they did not select. Okay, you emit much, I will impact you more. Not like that. Everyone get the same impact. So that by every country and everyone have to acting now in terms of that and every sector. Just to show you in terms of the infographic, when we can present it about the greenhouse gases emission. If we, for example, Thailand emitted one Thai people, me, Ajahn Subishia, also emitted 3.6 ton of carbon dioxide equivalent. We call carbon dioxide equivalent. It means we not measure only carbon dioxide. We measure more than one type of greenhouse gases, but we will summation up to be carbon dioxide equivalent because carbon dioxide is the main gas that we concern. Thailand emit allow 3.6 per capita per year 3.6 ton of carbon dioxide equivalent per capita per year. One ton of carbon dioxide, if we show as a volume of gas, is bigger than London bus. So I emitted in average almost 4 times from the balloon, blue balloon that you show per year, per year. In terms of agricultural, for example, 1 kilogram of grapes from South Africa emitted the volume of greenhouse gases around 32 Coca-Cola can, 32 Coca-Cola can. If you place it, 32 Coca-Cola can, the volume is allowed to 250 millimeter, 32 can. This is the total greenhouse gases that emitted from 1 kilogram of grapes produces from African region, for example. If you go to, for example, you living in studio apartment, 25 square meter with electrical heating in a recent building, is a modern building and not a very long, long time. 1 year is mean normally you emit from this, just only staying this, around 1 ton of carbon dioxide equivalent also. You see that when we are talking about how we contributing to climate change, we have to present it as carbon dioxide equivalent emission. This is the common way to talking in the international platform. So that's why it is necessary that when we are talking about how the agricultural can do it in terms to reduce the greenhouse gases, carbon footprint, when the industrial can do that, carbon footprint, when about the people, one head of people contribute to greenhouse gas emission and climate change, carbon footprint. Carbon footprint can show up by per product or per capita or per organization or per area, per everything, but have to show in terms of carbon footprint. The carbon footprint, also water footprint or other footprint. For example, if maybe we can be compared of in terms of concern the product, it concern the impact from emerging disease, maybe COVID-19 footprint or everything. Is it mean we have to thinking as life cycle concept? We are computed in terms that, okay, based on their own life cycle, since the first until the end, how many of greenhouse gases that they emitted along the way of we are living, of they are producing until the end at the landfill. This is the life cycle thinking. Normally, it means they computed that, for example, the one of the agricultural sectors, so they have to compute it, the emission of greenhouse gases in the farm. Transportation to the consumer, during they consume that agricultural product, how many greenhouse gases emitted from that. And even though after consumption, maybe there are some waste transported to the landfill or incinerators to disposal that partial that become as a waste. Also, how many the greenhouse gases emitted at that state also. That we compute it. So then, does it mean if from the former slide, if they computed 1 kilogram of capes from African region emitted around, okay, 3 tons, allow maybe two kilogram of the greenhouse gases or carbon dioxide equivalent, does that mean they compute since you are planting the grape? until you harvest the grape, until that grape is transported, until to reach the consumer. And if some part of grape you didn't eat all, maybe there are some part of grape you dispose into the trash. And in the trash, after that, they're transported to the landfill. So then we have to compute sin deferred until the landfill. This is a total carbon emission per unit of the grape that we presented. When I are working with the crab meat, canned crab meat, that I told you that this is a case of the factory that sent most of their product to Europe, to selling in European country. So then when I computed greenhouse gases emitted from canned crab meat, if it means I have to compute sin, the fishermen go to the sea and catch them. Because the link you go to the sea catch this crab, you also have to use that sail for your boat, for your ship, right? So then this is also, it's the partially that you emitted the carbon dioxide because you burn the fuel because you would like to catch that crab. So the fuel footprint already attached on that crab. And after they are brought into the land and sent to the factories, and also canned, seal on the can, on the metal can, put the label, everything. So everything is due for this crab meat. So this is a footprint app to embed on crab meat. And I have to compute how they send to France. They carry by ship. They carry by ship. Also, some part of fuel that used for travel from Thailand to France. This is travel for that crab meat. So then some part of carbon footprint from the fuel that used for trip of ship transportation have also embedded to crab meat. So then when go to when they arrive in Marseille port at France, and after that they are the truck transported to the retail, go to a supermarket, and every state that crab meat have to be chilled. It means have to be kept in some temperature, refrigerated temperature, cannot keep in the ambient temperature. So then all of this, all electricity that we spend for preserve that food, this is their footprint. We have to compute all of this. And finally, we can find that, okay, if we cut to see only from the factory part, what point that consume more the energy, consume more the resources, and emit more the carbon footprint? Because maybe you're thinking, oh, how far Thailand to Marseille in France, very long line. So if we computed the fuels for the ship transportation, so the crab meat is very high carbon footprint, but in that ship, they're not carry only the crab meat one can, right? They carry many, many kind of the product from Thailand to France. So we have to, like we do, just only compute the fraction of the fuel that uses for this canned. So very, very few. And from my experience, okay, this slide just show you that actually all country already have the carbon label. If the some kind of the some product can compute carbon footprint, so they can put the level of carbon footprints on their own product. So what is the benefit that they can get from this? Well, okay. In ideally that customer can comparing, okay, product A, product B, this is the same product, and okay, which one is emit lower greenhouse gases, so I will pick up this. It's ideally, but actually all all product do like this with voluntary. Most of country is voluntary system to compute carbon emission. But this is the branding system. Is it mean add some value to the brand? When you have the carbon label on the product, is it mean, oh, this product is concerned about the environmental impact, especially the significant impact like a climate change. And also it did some kind of trade barriers in some country. All product that would like to sell in France, you have to show carbon emissions. So then if we have, we can send to selling in that country. So it's like this. So Thailand, the label of Thailand is on your right hand side. In UK, you can see like a footprint, real footprint, right? But you see that in Korea, in Japan, Thailand, we don't use exactly foot logo because, in Asian culture, the foot is not a quite good thing like this. So we in Korea, they use like, the tree leaf. And in Thailand, we use like the logo that save the world and present the value on that. So in the banana company that I helping them to do the carbon footprint, also now their own product, they declare the carbon footprint on their bag. I showed you later. Maybe in the foreign country, even though from UK in Boots company that selling about cosmetics, there are 1 zillion of Boots product that declare their carbon footprint for many years. My another case is, you know what is it? The product that asked me to compute the carbon footprint in Thailand. This is Coca-Cola. Why they have to do like this? Because the company that are selling Coca-Cola in Thailand, they are two big company now that dealing with the Coca-Cola and get the get the brand to produce the Coca-Cola, to produce the Coca-Cola and selling in Thailand. And this is the first case of my experience to be the carbon footprint assessor. They have to do because even though it's not requirement from government and also the Coca-Cola that they produce, they're just only selling in Thailand, not send another country, because in other countries they also have their own Coca-Cola company. But the main office of Coca-Cola in New York asks for all company branch in all country to compute greenhouse gases emission from their own product. My first product that I compute is the 1.5 liter of Coca-Cola in plastic bottle. And you know that after the main office of Coca-Cola get the information from company branches, okay, they get the value, of carbon footprint, right? But actually behind the scene that I told you, I send the report to show the computing in detail. And they found that, you know, one part of the Coca-Cola bottle that can emit the carbon footprint much or greenhouse gases, this is the bottle. Because they produce from plastic bead. And they have to do like a molding to be as a bottle, right? And so then the carbon footprint or the greenhouse gases emission from the bottle, it depends on the quantity of plastic bead that you use to molding up the bottle. And they found that actually they can produce the bottle with more thin wall. That more thin wall, and it's very more easier to crash after consume all Coca-Cola and reduce the volume of waste. But So then after that, in some series of Coca-Cola, you can see that Coca-Cola company distribute the policy that all Coca-Cola bottle can reduce the thickness of the wall by reduce the plastic bead that used to molding up the bottle. So what does it mean? So they can reduce the carbon footprint that attached on Coca-Cola in the part of the package, in the part of package. But the main original benefit is they can reduce the cost of Coca-Cola, the cost for producing Coca-Cola. But they sell the same price. But they can save some cost of plastic. And they can claim that also, after you consume, so this plastic can be wrapped more easier. And so then they can reduce the volume of waste and very easily to transport for recycling, something like that. Also, after that, other company that produce about the water bottle also use the same idea. You see that? So just think, I just okay, lights up the examples I did, but actually we can also intervene in all kind of product, all food product. For the banana case, I found that okay, I give them okay the logo of carbon footprints, but behind the scene, I give them a report to the farm owner. This is very big farm in Thailand, very very big farm. That based on the carbon footprints or greenhouse gases emission from banana production, from banana farming, I found that the main part of emission come from fertilizer use, because they use the a little bit overuse of fertilizer, because they would like to confident that banana will be big, have a big size as expect. So even though they know that okay, what exactly quantity of fertilizer should be used, but they use in over. And so then it make more the carbon footprint or greenhouse gases emission from that part. So does it mean just recall them to back up, to back from that point? So just try to reduce the fertilizers. So then you can reduce the greenhouse gases emission, but actually does it mean your money? You gain back your money, because fertilizer is money. Plastic bottle of Coca-Cola is money. Or if you would like to save some water in some product, because you consume very much product, like in the Sulimi factory that I working on another part in the cleaner technology, they use a lot of water to wash the fish meat, something like that. If you can save the water, you can reduce the greenhouse gases, but in the blanket, it is your money. Everything is just your money. In one factory is also, after we deploy cleaner technology, and we found that they lost the money in the wood fire. They just buy the wood to use as the fuel in the factory, and they just left the wood on some area in the factory. And so then that wood is decomposed by themselves without using. This is money. Everything is money. So if we can convince a farmer to do as a mitigation, reduce the greenhouse gases emission, of course, this is help them in terms to coping themselves from the impact in the long future coming impact. But also, actually, we are help them immediately in terms to save the money. This is actually the concept behind the zine from my as I told you that okay, when I compute the carbon footprint to show about the current status of the greenhouse gases emission, you see that okay, final outcome of carbon footprint, this is the value. Okay, for example, this case is this carbon footprint of Tropicana POP mem orange juice. So is it mean, okay, one unit of Tropicana pure orange juice emitted 1.7 kilogram of CO2 or carbon dioxide equivalent. This is a one Tropicana orange juice emit like this based on whole life cycle of their production. But we can obtain this value when we have to computing in the each part of their life cycle. For example, you see that from this one, okay, juice production to come from planting the orange, right? So then you have to track back what the orange come from. Orange come from orange farming. And after it is about, okay, just okay, put the orange juice in the bottle. And distribution, it is transportation, packaging, using. Based on my experience, you can believe me that, based on many cases of my experience, if it is the food product, agricultural based product, that is the, have to include the farming activity in their whole life cycle for greenhouse gases emission assessment, we found that the main part of our food product that emitted the greenhouse gases is come from farming. But in my banana case, it's the same. The main part of greenhouse gases emission from the product is farm. Tropicana orange juice also. In this case, 60% come from orange juice production. This is come from farming. And when take back to the farming, they found that 58% contributed from fertilizer production and application. You see that? So this is the behind the scene that the farmer or industrial owner would like to know. This one, it is for brand, for the brand, for image. And also it is a, okay, this is a value and information benefit for the user, government sector or something else, someone else. But behind the scene that they know that, okay, if you would like to reduce the Tropicana orange juice emission, does it mean main point that we would like to concern is this about fertilizer use? Like in the case of my banana product, it is the same. Okay, this is it that I show you that this is, I captured from my, this is a Coca-Cola, my first product. After that, there are the crab meat, and banana, fresh banana in the wrap bag, that's selling in the supermarket and 7-Eleven, right? Also like that. And in this one, these three I show you because this is the product that reach to consumer until eating. So then we can put the value on their label. But there are another product that is it not a fruit product? For example, the rubber smoke sheet, that is a product, raw product to produce like a tie or like another elastic product that Thailand also send the rubber product to another country to produce the, to be at the, another final product for consumer. In that case, if you cannot compute it, the carbon footprint since the first until the consumer. So normally we cannot put, in Thailand, we cannot put the value on the product, but to be as a baseline data. But Coca-Cola, crab meat, and banana, this is a consuming product, consumable product. So I can compute it since cradle to grave, since the birth until death in the landfill. So then it is the overall greenhouse gases emission, and we can show in the label that I told you.
And
I told you that, okay, actually, before we can know that what is the greenhouse gases emission from, for example, this banana product
or
carbon footprint product, we have to know that, okay, based on their final footprint, they're contributing from which one. So normally we have to listing
all
the raw material, resource and energy in their production.
Don't charge you now, no,
sorry. Just
a moment. Perfect, Sarah, perfect. นี่แม่เด้
นิ้วเค้าก็ได้อ่ะอ๋อ
เฮาเดี๋ยวมันแล่เพิ่นมาทีนี้จูโดริยะสิเนาะ
อาจารย์อิมมิวเค้าได้มั้ยคะ
ทีนี้แม่อ๋อดีแม่ไม่ใช่ล่ะ
อย่าจะจะสมมุติอันนั้นโอเคโอเค so does it mean we have to know about the all of raw materials and resource and energy that they spend for banana production, for example, to productvery simple product like a banana and put in plastic bag, they have to use banana, fresh banana, have to attach with sticker, barcode, they have to use PVC tape to wrap up on the plastic on the plastic bag and also the plastic bag. So all of these, they have their own footprints since they was born in the world. BananaHave their own banana footprint from the farm. Sticker, barcode, PVC, plastic bag. They have their own footprint since they are produced in plastic factory. Right? And also energy. Darling, we produce the wrap plastic. Also, we have to use the water. We have to use the electricity.And we have to use the fuel in something. And all of these also have their own footprint. So if we would like to calculate the carbon emission from any kind of product, so that's why we have to compute all their own attached footprint from all of the part, from all of the part.For examples, when they produce the fresh banana, so we have to compute it since what? Since they are doing the tillage in the farm to starting the crop. The crop life cycle of banana is around 9 months. Since starting with the tillage and until they harvest the banana, around 9 to 12 months, but 9 months is the optimist that can obtain the first batch of banana as a very good. So you can see that based on the process, since the tillage until banana planting maintaining the banana until they provide you the fruit. And after that, we maintain until the fruit is going up obtain the big size as expected, and then they harvesting. You see that based on this, what is the list of the resource that we use? When you do the tillage, this is you consume the diesel. You buy the diesel, put on tractor. And during the tractor is working, there are the combustions. So even though the diesel also have their own footprint, first part. Second part, it is the direct emission during combustion, during their work. And also, after they planting the banana that they use the human, it is okay, no carbon emission, okay? And so then they leave the banana plant going up. They have to do watering. They're watering the banana plant every day.But they did not use the human because it's quite a 1,000 acre or something. So they use the small machine, small boat. to watering. And so this water boat is moving on the small canal between the pie. And so then they move and the back and the watering, just like they sweep the water until reach to the banana plant. So this small boat use the diesel also. So to produce the banana, of course, this diesel also attached to the banana footprint. Gasoline for mower, okay, the farmer have to do doing with the mower to cut off the herb that they don't want to maintain about the that the plant can be consumed the fertilizer as much as not sharing with the grass or weed something. So this is they use the gasoline. And also to obtain the big size of fresh banana, they apply 7 types of fertilizer based on the banana plant age. 7 types along 9-month period, because they would like to confident that the banana plants is growing up well, and also they provide the food. Oh, very, very big size. So this is about the product income, something. And when they have some undesirable plants on the farm, they use the herbicides sometimes. After that, when the fruit come out, to protect the fruit from the insect or some kind of undesirable condition, they protect the banana fruit with the plastic, blue plastic bag, very big, to cover the banana and let them growing up inside. So plastic also is the footprint of banana. They use the ribbon because the ribbon have to tie the banana and the bag. They have the bamboo blast that you can see, because the banana fruit is very heavy. And the banana tree is really not too much strong. So they have to use the wood base or bamboo base to support the banana fruit until the time of harvesting. And as I told you that for the fossil fuel or even though like an alternative fuel like a biogas or something, when you combust them, they also emit the direct emissions of greenhouse gases. You see that just only one piece of banana, they already take a culture of very many, many footprints on them. And when you see that, if you can qualify of the each quantity that consume for banana production from each resources, so you will know that which one is contributing at the most resources that consume your money, consume the farmer money for growing up the banana, and equally to the carbon emission also, something like that. And so then this is the final outcome from my banana case, for example. Okay, they sell as 4 pieces in one bag. Actually, I compute for them for 3 products. They are the one banana, just one piece in one bag, and 2 pieces in one bag, and 4 pieces in one bag. They decide their product depend on the customer need. Like, okay, you see that. Finally, this farm obtained the result like for one product that contain 4 pieces or fresh banana in wrapped plastic bag, they emitted around 829 grams of carbon dioxide equivalent per one product from this farm. And these 129 grams of carbon equivalent or greenhouse gases emission, this is come from what part? At the mainly raw material. They come from banana, actually. come from banana, and this is the process in the factory. It just process. It just like watching banana dry up, put in the bag. Just only that. This is the factory, and after that there are transportation from the factory to the retail to the customer size something, and this is the consumption. This is the consumption. What is consumption? What is during consumption? Does it mean that after the distribution, I track the product of this farm, and I found that during that they are waiting to selling to the customer. They are selling in supermarket, and in supermarket, of course, does it mean on that shelf? That this is a normal temperature. This is under air conditioning environment. So this is a part of the sharing of electricity on this product. Or if the food product have to be chilled, have to be kept in refrigerator, does that mean this part is contribute from electricity that you use for keep that product until you consume it, until you consume. And for the disposal, because after that, the consumer throw away the plastic bag, throw away the PVC tape, and throw away about the part of banana that they don't eat. No, normally it's about the yellow part that you wrap off, right? And then you throw away on that. So this is the landfill part, take of this. You see that. This is the two main parts. So in this part, of course, it is in terms of society size. So it means we have to try to reduce the food waste. If we can do something with some food waste to be collect, to be used for the composting or to do something, so it should be good something. And the part that the factory can do it, It is the part of farm and factory. This is the part of consumer science. So does it mean they have to go back to the farm and to see what happened? What happened? And I can show you with this slide. Sorry that I have to show in China because actually it's a secret of the company. It is a secret of the company. You see that the main emission here. It is come from the two types of fertilizer that they use much. And this one is the quantity that they use per one crop. And it is diverse for the per functional unit or per size of product or unit of product. And when you use the quantity multiply with emission factor, this is a emission that it come from Thailand emissions database. In many countries now, they try to set their own emission database. It's when you to compute the carbon, you to compute the greenhouse gases emission in their own country. We also have the international database, but normally there are producers in the developed country. So maybe sometimes it's not fit with our own country. So the main point that every country can do is to try to develop their own database in terms of emission factor. What is emission factor? Is it mean emission factor have to be proved from the scientific research to quite sure that, for example, the database is one unit of electricity produced in Thailand that emit how many greenhouse gases emission quantity. So then when we compute the greenhouse gases emission from some house, so how many unit of electricity they consume? So we multiply with emission factor. So we know that suddenly how much of greenhouse gases emitted from that house. So from quantity, multiply with emission factor, we will know the carbon footprint or greenhouse gas emission level. And on this case, on this banana case, we found that this is come from farming in the part of fertilizer, in the part of two types of fertilizer, that is the main part. So this is the point that the farm owner should be concerned in terms that they have to try to reduce the greenhouse gases emission or reduce the producing cost. And of course, when they show their status on their product, you cannot stop. Is that mean in the next year or in the next following coming year, they have to try to show lower value each year. So this is the way up after that. So based on the first time that you show the carbon label in Thailand, after that, if some kind of farm or factory can reduce the greenhouse gases emission, so they will obtain another carbon label we call carbon reduction label. Does it mean this is a started point, but can help the farmer or manufacturing owner, agricultural product manufacturing owner to know about their situation and to know themselves what part that contributing much in terms of resources consumed, money payment, and so then try to reduce that point to be hit the point, and then it will be come out with the result with a lower greenhouse gases emission later, something like that. And this is for example, this is the key, you know, that it's just the part of most difficult of carbon footprint is not computation, but it is the part of try to collect the data, because normally especially in the farming system, they did not like a record everything in detail. But if you're working with industrial sector, their data is very, very detailed. And for me, it's very easily to compute. Comparing when I working with a farm, with farmer. Okay, you know this data, I did not record, but I can remember something like that. So we have to prove and validate the data very much also. For example, if to computing the carbon footprint or CF, it's just only one equation. It's come from the eventually, or is it mean the quantity of the resource that you consume for the producing something, but have to compute in functional unit. In functional unit, does that mean if we present the Thailand people emitted the greenhouse gases per capita, one head of people is functional unit. If I computing the carbon footprints of Coca-Cola bottle, one bottle is functional unit. Normally, functional units what have to be designed rely on the behavior of consumption. We did not compute Coca-Cola 2 bottle because we did not drink 2 bottle at the same time. We drink only each one. Or when the people come to buy a grapes or orange, the consumer buy per kilo. So then normally when we design to measure the carbon footprints of anything, we have to decide it on the functional unit to compute it. So when presents like, okay, 1 kilo of 1 kilo of orange, 1 kilo of grapes, 1 bottle of milk, 1 kilo of meat, one bottle of water or beverage, something like that. 1 kilo of rice, 1 piece of bread. This is a functional unit that we use to present the carbon footprint. And just only use the functional unit of each and eventually per functional unit multiply with emission factor. Just only that. this is a carbon footprint. And don't be worried, nah. I also, after the lecture, I give you some very simple exercise. But I took from the real data, nah, from my work, that to show you. It is a basic principle and concept to compute the emission factors. Nah, but I think now it's the come up in the Google Classroom. And for any one of you that still cannot access to the Google Classroom, so please contact the administrators, because all of the lectures and exercise assignments, so they will provide you by Google Classroom also. Okay, the slide maybe come up in the website, but normally Google Classroom is used for you to submit all assignments. That is a part of the criteria for the training court graduations also. And so then, based on this, to reducing a farm or estate carbon footprint based on the concept. So what we can do, I summarize this from some kind of documents talking about agricultural technologies. So based on the concept that we have been taught today and tomorrow, the carbon footprint and water footprint, I hopefully that after that, you will read to the point that the invited speakers come to talk with you with agricultural technology. So you can attach this concept to thinking. For example, the speaker talking about the technology that they apply to the farm to reduce the water consumption. So you can imagine immediately that if they can reduce the water consumed per crop by applying some technologies. So normally, of course, water footprint should be reduced. And for the carbon footprints, okay, should be reduced also. If that water have their own footprint, you can see from the banana case. You can see from the banana case. The water that used for watering in the farm, this is not free carbon, zero carbon water, even though this is the water come from some canal. But because when you use the water, you use some machine that consume that cell. So it means your water is not free carbon. Your water also have the carbon footprint or emitted the carbon greenhouse gases. So it is important that if your farm is under some kind of irrigated technology, so is it mean we have to thinking that even though you reduce the water consumption in the farm, but if that farm is come from some kind of irrigated technology, so they also emitted the carbon footprint or water footprint. But of course, if you raising the productivity, you can cut farm carbon, of course, because if we back to the concept of carbon footprint, the carbon footprint come from the inventory, right? Multiply with the emission factor. The inventory is, what is this? For example, inventory is the fertilizer. Used per crop, for example, used per crop. And the crop is, okay, you produce 1 ton of food product. You consume X number of fertilizer per 1 ton of food product. So does it mean if you produce the same crop quantity, but you can reduce X value, does it mean you increase the productivity? For example, former, when you produce the product A, you consume 1 kilogram of nitrogen per 1 kilogram of product A or fruit A or fruit A. And if you can raise the productivity, is that mean even though in the case B, in the case A, after to do something about some technology, so you still consume the same of fertilizer, but you can increase 2 kilogram of product. So the productivity in the case of A is 1 kilogram of product A per 1 kilogram of nitrogen. Is it equal to 1? But the productivity, if you apply something to raising the productivity, AT, you can produce 2 kilogram of A per 1 kilogram of N consumed. So the productivity is 2, double. So of course, is it mean when you increase the productivity, in comparing, you consume less of fertilizer on the same way. So that's why if increasing the productivity can cut the farm carbon. This is the one way. Cutting emission, okay, from improving fertilizer use, okay, is the connecting with the examples. Because you improving fertilizer use, what does it mean? Actually, based on the FAO report, the tentative of farming around the world use excess or overuse of fertilizer. Thailand is the one of that country in the list. So the farmer tend to use in over of fertilizer because they believe that if you did not provide the enough fertilizer, so then the product maybe cannot come up with the the expectation. So they like a pool, dumping again. So actually, the improved fertilizer use in that way normally based on the report is it mean try to help the farmer to get the appropriate fertilizer consumption point. Is it mean based on the available technology? Normally, we know that based on many reports, scientific publications, for example, we know that on this state of rice, so they need just only this quantity of some nutrients, something. So try to use the precise fertilizer consumption based on the need of the plant, not based on the need of farmer or confident of farmer, something like that. And cutting emissions by improving energy efficiency. That I will give you some examples of this based on my former experience. And cutting emission by improved energy efficiency. Okay. And grant support from low carbon farming. Maybe it is some time that I already talking with you since the first, in some project that Thai government deployed. For example, if you are apply in the carbon footprint assessment project, so your farm will receive some support in terms of the budget to do something. Or if you apply or involved in the cleaner technology project of government, it means try to find some hotspot to reduce the consumption of resources. And of course, in terms to reduce the carbon footprint, so you will obtain some support, small budget that the farm or can buy some small machine or can do something in that farm to increase the productivity or to save the cost of energy, something like that. This is the way that we can initiate in terms to improving the efficiencies of agricultural sectors, especially in the small farm, and can help them in term to increase the capacity of mitigation, reduce the greenhouse gases, and when they change their practice, of course, that they are adapting. Okay, the first benefit that they receive is save the cost, save energy, save fertilizer, save any kind of resources that they use in their farm. But in the overall picture, it is the way that we are contributing to coping the climate change impact by starting from the lower level. You can see that when we are talking about climate change in all countries, climate change is a global issue. We're talking as a very big state, come from greenhouse effect, come from the temperature around the world, the thing. And we, after that, all international platform try to find out a common way, a common guideline to transform this way to be as a policy. And the policy transferred to all country. And this is the way that the policy and transfer the guideline to be a practice. But when in the way of practice, we have to start from the smallest point, come from the farm. And after that, if every farm is involved, so then they will come up to be a bigger impact in the region, in the area, in the district. And if every district come up to be country, and if every country is taking this action, so of course it will come up to be at the world response. Okay, this is the idea. And also like increasing renewable energy, or maybe I think it's very close to in term by improving energy examples. I will show you that it is on my work also. In Thailand, in term of agricultural, okay. In addition from that, we are the main country that export the food for many countries around the world. But another economic crop that is not food product, but also it is a very important agricultural product that we exported, right? Also like a palm oil, and also rubber smoke sheet that Thailand exported at the third rank in the world. Rubber smoke sheets, normally the farm is located in the southern of Thailand. So the tree is what the cutting to make a scar, and so then they will release about the thick white liquid, that is the rubber. And after that, thick white liquid will be passed some process to kept to be as a solid cube. And then after that solid cube maybe to use to produce something immediately, or maybe they will doing at a flat sheet, and they smoke it with the rubber smoke sheet, so they can transport in other part of the world. Why can we keep the quality of rubber until they use to produce many kind of product that use a rubber as a part of raw material? So then in Thailand, the rubber farm normally in each farm, the farmer they will gathering as a group, or we call cooperation, right? They're gathering to be a group, because if you sell your own product from your own farm, so maybe you have not the power to consensus about the price between you and the someone who come to sell your rubber. But if you gathering to be at a group, to be as a cooperation, so then it mean you not sell by yourself, but you gathering and you sell to the group. You sell to the group, and the group will be gathering the product as a big mass products, and so then they can dealing the price with the factories or someone or someone that would like to buy the rubber products, and also the profit from the cooperation agency, the cooperation agency, they will distribute back to the farmer. So it is double profit. So in the southern part of Thailand, in each community, they will have the small rubber sheet. They have the small rubber sheet. So the farmer just take the liquid from their farm and go to this small factory in their own community. And this factory, they just have the simple process to change the liquid to be the solid sheet, and they smoke. After they smoke, they gathering all the product and send to the central market in the region and can get the appropriate price, appropriate size, because they have the the sharing mass of product, not selling one by one like this. So in the rubber smoke cheese, of course, based on the process to produce, to transform the liquid to be solid, they have to use some kind of strong acid and consume a lot of water. So then it's produced very, very polluted wastewater from this process. And another part, it is about the energy consumption for smoking the sheet, because they have to put in some kind of the room that have to heating for 1 week until can obtain the very dry rubber sheet. And so then the very dry rubber sheet can send around the world without become processed in terms of quality. So when from like this, so at that time, so I was asked to conduct one project to compute the greenhouse gases emission. And with my partner, with my colleague, try to that he has been working, try to apply some technology to help these farmer cooperation to reduce the cost of the energy that consume in smoking process. What we have found from my research, I found that for 1 kilogram of smoke sheet rubber that the farmer corporation produces, they emitted around 2 kilogram of carbon dioxide equivalent. And based on the carbon greenhouse gas emission computations, 87%, this is come from raw material, come from rubber plantation and their transportation from the truck that carry this product until reach to the central market. And 11% come from wastewater treatment pond. If you see that, you can see the wastewater treatment pond here. Normally in the normal activity, they're just digging the pond. And for the all wastewater with strong acids, with all contamination, they just discharge into the pond and use the natural mechanism to decompose themselves. But it creates a lot of problem, like odors all community nearby that very got the bad odor from the wastewater decompose in that pond. And sometimes when the rain comes, so there are the overflow of these wastewater and contaminated to the canal or the river basin nearby. So this is not good at all because it's very high polluted. So what is the we can do about this? Okay, even though the 11% contributed from this pond, but we found that this wastewater have the very high capacity to produce the methane, produce biogas. So what is our project doing? So my colleague designed the biogas system. The simplest way for description is just cover the pond with the geotile, just cover the pond. And when you cover the pond, of course, this pond is decomposes and they emit the methane inside. But this methane and other part of biogas did not emission into the air because they capture, they was captured by this CO2 plastic. They capture and after that, what that they use, they just discharge this biogas by the tube connected to this pond and go to the oven that create the heat energy for the smoking room. So is it mean there are two benefits that they get immediately? First, is it mean they prevent the pollution from the wet water pond? And of course, they get the biogases to use in the smoking oven instead of firewood. And what is the firewood? Firewood is the money that the farming corporation factory have to pay. Almost in Thailand is 2 baht per kilo, but you use it 1,000 kilo or more than 1,000 kilo. So it means all of this per day. So this is the cost. So after we do like this, so is it mean what will happen? Will you do this one? So is it mean, of course, 20% of emission from wastewater, you can reduce. And also when you use the biogas instead of firewood and the supplement, some part of firewood that you use at the normal fuel from the smoking room. So it means some part of processing and raw material will be reduced also. And we found that we apply this biogas system and use the biogas supplemented with the firewood for the smoking process. So the carbon footprint of the smoked sheet rubber reduced from around 2 kilogram carbon dioxide equivalent to be 1.9. But 1.9 per kilogram, but actually when Thailand export these rubber sheet to the global market, we export 1,000 ton or 10,000 ton per year. So how the emissions, greenhouse gas emission that Thailand can be reduced from just only apply all these system into the farming corporation factories that located or distributed in the southern part of Thailand for almost 40 factories. So this is the thing that we do. And they can, instead of this one for a one cycle of processing, and in 1 year, how many cycling that they have been doing. So is that mean, actually, when we compute overall as annual greenhouse gas reduction from this rubber smoke sheet factory can reduce a lot. And of course, this is a reduce the footprints of Thailand product that we send to the foreign country. This is a way that we use the tools of the carbon footprints to design or to find out what kind of the part of the agricultural process or in the farm or in the factories that we should be deployed in terms to reduce the consumption of resources. And of course, we will get the benefits immediately in terms of the natural resource consumption or use. And of course, in the long-term effect, it is also that we are contributing to solving the problem of climate change for our world and save to our kids, save for our next generation. So this is a all of the my lecture. I'm so sorry that can be go deeper in terms of the carbon footprint, but I totally can show you that only one question that used for the carbon emission calculator. After that, this is about the data collections and data management and interpretation to design for the system to improve the farming efficiency or other system efficiency. So I'm preparing some exercise for you. It is a simplified one, but it actually the same exercise that I started to teach my student in master or PhD student is the same. So I will show that. So now the exercise is available on the Google Classroom. I already posted in the classroom work. So let me share that one. So I just took from my work. For examples, is it a banana farming? That I think can show that the power of this tool, even though to apply in the farm something. So I provide you the table that informing about the materials and the resource that used for the farming process. I provide you this one. I provide you about the quantity of each raw material used that I took from my case. It is the quantity that they use. And it is the emission factor. What does it mean? Emission factor is mean this cell. To produce 1 liter of this cell, they already have their own emission, 0.3 kilogram of carbon dioxide equivalent per liter. So it means their own genetic. It's like when we was born, there are something attached in our body since we was born. And also fertilizer A, for example, to produce fertilizer A at some factory, 1 kilogram of fertilizer A produced, they emitted 1.6 kilogram of carbon dioxide, for example. So this is the raw data that I providing you, and you will obtain the fresh banana 11 ton for consuming of this thing. Okay, this is the raw data that I provide to you. And what that I would like you to do, please calculate the carbon footprint of banana harvested from this farm. So what the thing that you can do, if you remember that, I talking that when we present the carbon footprints, we have to define the functional unit. So then the banana, normally we present at per kilogram, it's per kilogram because we're selling by kilogram of banana in every market. So then first from quantity that you use for one crop, you have to transform to be inventory of functional unit by what? By you can use the quantity divided by product. Or 11 tons. So you will obtain how many this cell you will consume per kilogram of banana here in this column. Right? You just divided all of this quantity by the product of fresh banana that come out. Because this is a quantity used for one crop of banana. And one crop of banana, you get 11 tons by you use overall almost 500 liter of this cell for probing. So is it mean if we computed functional unit to be 1 kilogram of banana, how many liter of this cell used for them? So to be eventually functional unit. So all of these can be transformed by you divide you divide by product quantity. Quantity per crop, because this is the we sell per crop. Okay, you will get eventually per functional unit, and then you bring the emission factor. You bring the emission factor based on if it is a column A, it is a column B. Carbon footprint is the A multiply B. Okay, and so then the overall carbon footprint. So overall here, overall carbon footprint of this banana, it is the summation of A multiplied B. Okay, so then if you calculate each one, A could be one, A could, second A could be, so summation of D, it is the overall carbon footprint of fresh banana. Fresh banana, 1 kilo. I recommend you to do, because if you do that, so tomorrow for water footprints will be very easy for you, because you will get the basic concept to compute it one. But actually it's very easy. But when we are working in the real condition, it's very hard in terms like when we have to compute it or correcting the data, and sometimes we have to normalize some data to be at the unit that finally we can compute it for carbon footprint. This is the most difficult, but it is the basic concept. If we get all the quantity of inventory you use, you get all the emission factors, so then you can do. Sometimes in my work, I cannot find the carbon, the emission factor from my country database, you know. This is very, very hard. In the in the case of crab meat, there is no database about emission factor of crab meat. So then my hard part that at that time is I have to follow the fisherman and record all data when they go up, when they go to the sea to cap the crab meat. So what is the thing that they do? And they, we have to record, and until I get the emission factor of crab meat to compute in the process of factory. And after that, a Thailand database use my work as a database for crab meat emission factor. So does it mean if someone come to compute carbon footprint after me, is it mean they can do, and if they would like to assess the crab meat carbon footprint, so they can use my emission factor to be at the reference, that's okay. So after that, when you get the overall carbon footprint, so I just would like you to ask the answer. So which item, which inventory that contribute highest greenhouse gas emission for 1 kilogram banana produced. Okay. And if you are the farming consultant, so I just would like you to keep the idea that one option is enough. You will recommend them to do what? That's only that. I think this is a simplified exercise, but it caps all important step. What is the carbon footprint? How is it the basically frame for computations? And it is a way that we use the results to apply for the farm or helping the farmer to increase their mitigation capacity, their adaptation capacity, and of course equally to their resilience to climate change. Okay. And after you finish that, you can submit this assignment to me via Google Classroom on under the section, because I post it in the Google Classroom at assignment. So normally there are the block that you can submit to that. But if you have any problem in terms of submission, you can contact a coordinator in some way. And also, I uploaded at the word files. So you can fill up with the add the electronic file and you submit chat back and you submit to me back. It's okay. If you can, if you are not convenient, you can print out and you're filling by handwriting. And after that, you scan or you took a photos and you submit back to me by that photos or by scan that document. It's okay. All is welcome. But just try to do that and submit back to me. Okay. This is that. That's all of today's session. Hopefully that there's some information occurred, not totally like catch on early case chat water management something, but I think that it's a basic but important concept and the thing that our world are talking about. And also after these sessions, after tomorrow's session, that you will learn about water footprint. After that, our technologies also you can thinking about encompassing with these tools. And maybe this is the one criteria that you can use to justify what technology that we will choose to help the farmers to improve their farming efficiency. Yes, for the email, if you are not convenient, you can send the email. I will inform the coordinator try to catch up your email also. But anyway, if there are based on the due date, if I still not receive some submission for someone, I will ask the coordinator to remind you again. Okay, but if impossible, so if it's possible, maybe submission via Google Classroom is quite to be good because we can track that. Okay, which one is submitted, which one is still not submitted. The email sometime like if we not catch on time, sometime we missing because a lot of the mail info into the email. Okay. Yes, and also everything will be dropped in the classroom about the video and the thing. Okay. And if you have any questions, you can leave on the message that Ajahn Supriya will be kept everything for you. And I will try to answer the best with some supporting document if I have. I will attach you back. And also, I think for all answer, I will post in Google Classroom also that everyone can access also. And that thing we can learn and share among all us. Okay? Thank you very much for your joining today's session because I know some of you have to wake up very, very early morning. Thank you very much for your commitment and engagement. Okay, so today I will leave you to do the exercise.
Today, can we take photo again because we have
someone come later. Okay. Please turn on your camera that we can do the photo again. Okay, if you miss some part, you did not worry, then you can follow the video record. And okay, all question or the thing is welcome. And I promised that I will sharing all chit-chat question and answer to you all.
Okay. Capture. Okay, thank you everyone.
And I will upload one supplementary document. This is about the PAS 2050. This is about the guideline about the carbon footprint calculation. Okay. That may be okay, useful for you. Okay, thank you very much. And see you tomorrow. Please try to do that exercise. And that okay, we will continue a little bit far for tomorrow. Will be another way to present it about the impact computations from farming activity. Carbon footprint concerns about the climate change impact. Water footprint concerns about water consumption. Okay. Thank you. And stay safe and take care, everyone. See you tomorrow. Have a nice day.
Okay. Oh, thank you. See you later.
See you. Yeah.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. See you tomorrow.